Hey everyone, welcome to SMCC Online. My name is Adam and I get to serve as the Campus Support Team Director here at South Mountain Community Church. And I really just love my job because I get to help lead and support our campuses across Utah. And speaking of those locations, I just want to welcome all of you here today. Those of you from our Draper locations, our South Jordan location, Lehigh Campus, St. George and International campuses as well. Welcome all of you here today. And for those of you that it's your first time here today, hey, I just want to say a special thank you. I know it takes a lot to actually sit down to open something up and to say, okay, I'm gonna stay here. I'm gonna watch this. I wanna see what's going on. Thank you so much for trusting us with your time. What I wanna let you know about is that we have staff that really want to connect with you. You might be watching this service, or maybe you've watched a few before. Maybe this is your first one. You say, hey, I've got some questions I need to get answered. I wanna know more about SMCC or about Christianity or about Jesus. I've got questions. Well, I want to let you know that we have staff that want to answer those questions for you. What you can do is go ahead and head to our website, open up a new tab right now, go to smccutah.org/next steps. And right there at the very top, there's going to be a connect button. You can click that button and we'll have staff reach out to you and get those questions answered for you. Well, now that we've got everybody here right now, we're gonna go ahead and jump into our service right now with our first song with our band, and it's one of my favorites. We're gonna sing the song Rule. So I'm gonna invite you to go ahead and join our band in singing this song.
Be the crown in the light and sound. Be the fire burning inside out. Be the love casting out all fear. Let your name rule the atmosphere.
Well, hey, thanks Taylor and the band for that song. I really do enjoy that song, and there's this lyric that always sticks out to me when we sing it. It's this lyric, "Let your name rule the atmosphere." And I think that this lyric and the idea of this song is just about inviting God's kingdom here on earth. And it's really just cool, this idea of a kingdom. And that might seem like a strange word to you, but I want to kind of break it down. A kingdom is where a king has rule, a king has influence. And so when we say God's kingdom, and we're talking about God's kingdom here on earth, what we're basically asking is for Jesus, his culture, to be here with us on earth, to bring dignity and care to people. And in fact, Jesus, as it's recorded in Matthew, he talks about this when he tells us how to pray. He asks us to invite this in in our prayer life when we pray to God. It says in this in Matthew 6, it says, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So it's this idea of asking for Jesus, his culture, his kingdom to come here on earth as we treat others with love and with grace and with dignity and with care. And so what I love about being here in Utah, not only working with SMCC, but being able to see a lot of other organizations that are inviting God's kingdom here on earth to care for other people. And so we've got a special guest here today. I'm going to invite Tanya up here on stage. She's the founder of Holding Out Help, and it's a great organization here in Utah. Now, Tanya, you're the founder of Holding Out Help. You've got a lot going on with Holding Out Help. Can you just give people like a 30-second explanation of what is Holding Out Help?
Yeah, thanks for that, Adam. So Holding Out Help provides those from a polygamous culture the care, support, and resources to become independent. And although we'll serve anybody from the culture, we really do specialize in serving those who have been kicked out, who have chosen to leave their communities. And most, Adam, unfortunately, come with the clothes on their backs. They think that they're actually condemned to hell. And so through our community support and educational support, we hope to bring them hope, dignity, and get them independent.
Wow, that's so cool. That's such a great kingdom-focused effort that you guys are doing. If people hear that and they say, "I want to be involved with that," what are ways that people can be involved with Holding Out Help?
Great question. So we are always looking for volunteers. Currently, we need tutors, we need host homes, and now that we're opening up from the pandemic, we're starting our social groups. So we're looking for two strong females, two strong male leaders that can run these groups. And if you also have a specialty skill, like you know how to make jewelry or soap, or you're a wood maker, and you want to share those skills and teach our people that, we would love to have you involved.
Wow, that's so cool. What are ways that people can find out more information or get in contact with you?
Great question again. So you guys can find us on our website at holdingouthelp.org. We're also on Facebook, we're on Instagram, or you can reach us by phone at 801-548-3492.
Awesome. Well, Tanya, I appreciate you coming out here and explaining this to everybody. I think it's a cool ministry. You're inviting the kingdom of God here on earth and spreading that to other people. So I appreciate you coming down. Thank you.
Thanks, Adam.
Well, everybody, I'm really excited to be talking about Holding Out Help, but also I'm just as excited to be going into our week 3 of the Gospel According to Peter. This is a series that I've really enjoyed. I think we have a lot to take from it. And so we're going to go ahead and join Pastor Eric as we go through this week 3 of the series, the Gospel According to Peter. Let's go ahead and join him now.
I don't consider myself a traditional person, but I do like some tradition. I'm Eric. I'm one of the pastors here. Thank you so much for joining us. Special welcome to everybody at the Lehi location today. I don't consider myself a traditional person, but I do like some tradition. Every summer, my family, we take our vacation to the exact same place. Growing up, we did Christmas the exact same way every year. I love traditional tattoos. And when it comes to my birthday, I like to have the same dessert year after year after year. It's tradition. And there's something about tradition that really resonates with us. Tradition is like a warm blanket. Inside of tradition, we just feel so warm and we just feel so safe, which is why when tradition is upset, it can be incredibly upsetting. When someone says something or does something, or when we learn something new, something that challenges a tradition that we love, it can be so upsetting. It can feel like the warm blanket of tradition has been snatched away, and it can feel oh so cold. Now, there's one place where tradition can stand the test of time unlike any other place, and that is this place. It's this place. It's church. Church and religion, it's a breeding ground for tradition. And this isn't all bad, but it isn't all good either. The clothes and the language and the arts and the songs and the customs and the text, it all can become tradition. And here's what I think is so interesting about this. Check this out. Helpful traditions become harmful when we do it or we believe it and we don't know why. So I want to ask you a question this morning, a question that takes a whole lot of courage to ask, but even more courage to answer. The question that I have for all of us is this question right here. What do you do? What do you do when uncomfortable truth challenges comfortable tradition? When uncomfortable truth challenges a tradition that you love, challenges the warm blanket that is tradition for you, what do you do in that moment? Now, for some of us watching, for some of us listening, this isn't a hypothetical, this isn't a rhetorical question. You've lived this, or you are living this as we speak. So what do you do when uncomfortable truth challenges comfortable tradition? Maybe you get angry. Maybe you get sad. Maybe you grieve. Maybe you tune out all information. Or maybe you run from tradition as quickly as you can. Maybe you shut down. Maybe you freeze. Maybe you get confused. Maybe you want to just tune it all out all together. See, when truth challenges tradition, it can feel like our whole world is crumbling. When we come to discover that something that we thought was true is not true, I mean, it can shatter us. When you come to discover that something you held onto is as true, when you discover it isn't, when something that was so valuable to you becomes something that maybe was just made up for you, it can shatter you. And when this happens, it puts us at a crossroads in life, a crossroads that can have implications for the rest of our lives. So if what you thought was true turned out to be just a man-made and made-up tradition, I mean, wouldn't you want to know? I mean, wouldn't you want to know? And don't you think you owe it to yourself to know? That's what today is about, because I think we would all want to break through. We would all want to break through something that was just a man-made tradition, just some man-made rules, so that we could embrace truth. Regardless of how uncomfortable this experience might be, I think it's worth it for all of us. And that is what today is about. So welcome back to part three of a series that we are calling The Gospel According to Peter. Now, some of you are a little bit concerned because you've read the Bible. You've read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you don't remember a gospel of Peter. And you're right. In this series, we are studying two books at the same time. We are studying the Gospel of Mark and 1 Peter, or Peter's epistles, 1 and 2 Peter. And the reason we're studying these two is because these two come from the eyewitness perspective of Peter. It really is the good news of Jesus according to Peter. Peter was an eyewitness to the life of Jesus, a close friend and follower of Jesus. And he would later share his memories, his recollections of his time with Jesus, with Mark, who wrote them down and took these stories and put them together in a specific way in his gospel. And so we're looking at the Gospel of Mark, and we're laying over it truths from Peter's letters, his epistles, towards the end of the New Testament. And as we look at both of these pieces of information, we are seeing the good news about the life of Jesus according to Peter. And therefore, this series is called The Gospel According to Peter. Now, there was once a day when what you might call traditional Christianity was tradition-shattering Christianity. And today we're going to see this. We should always go with truth over tradition, and we should never let truth become just tradition. And to see this, we're going to look at a few things that Jesus did in the Gospel of Mark. Jesus engages this conversation about tradition in a very specific way. And what we're going to see today is that it really is focused on this tradition called the Sabbath. So we're going to pick it up today in Mark chapter 2, and then we're going to turn over to Mark chapter 3. Then we're going to skip a little bit of Mark, and we're going to kind of wrap up the conversation on tradition in Mark chapter 7. And then we're going to look at something Peter would say years and years later in 1 Peter chapter 5. So let's dive in Mark 2, and then we'll roll forward. In Mark 2, we see this incredible moment. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain field. So he's walking along with his followers. And as his disciples walked along, they began to pick some heads of grain. So they're walking through this field and they're picking heads of grain. And the Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is unlawful? Why are they doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath? This is against the Sabbath law." And Jesus answered, "Have you never read what David did?" David, Old Testament hero to these people. "What David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar, the high priest, he entered the house of God." David entered the house of God and ate the consecrated bread, which is lawful only for the priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions. And then he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man," he's referring to himself, "is Lord, even of the Sabbath." So like today, religious people then, they had traditions that they absolutely loved. They dressed a certain way for synagogue. They prayed a certain way. They sung a certain way. They acted a certain way. They read certain texts and they worshiped in certain buildings. They followed certain customs. They had certain hoops to jump through, certain classes to take, certain spiritual boxes to check. It was all part of their religion. It was part of their tradition, and they loved it. And then something happened that sort of shifted their perspective. Jesus showed up on the scene. And when Jesus showed up on the scene, he challenged some of these dearly loved traditions. And for these people who loved these traditions, they were being reminded of something. God is not just for them because they've done a good job with those traditions. God is for everyone. He's always been for everyone, but sometimes in tradition, you think that he must just be for you in your tradition. And so Jesus challenged all of that, and it threw this group of people, it threw the Pharisees, as you can imagine, into a tailspin. And it all centered around this thing called the Sabbath. The Sabbath was a cherished institution by the Jewish nation. It was given to the people of Israel by God when they were led out of Egypt. We see this pattern way back in Genesis, in fact, the seventh day God rested. But we see this thing called the Sabbath given as a gift to God's people as they leave Egypt. Now, here's what happened though. This truth of the Sabbath, this principle, this gift of the Sabbath, it was hidden by this point in time by the layers and layers and layers of human tradition that were placed upon the Sabbath. And so the truth of the Sabbath was hidden underneath all the traditions of the Sabbath. And this is what can happen. Sometimes traditions cover up and overshadow truth, and we cannot see truth anymore because all we see is tradition. And there were 39 Sabbath laws placed over people that people had to follow. Moses never gave these 39 rules, these laws. They were just placed on top of what Moses had given by the people who created this tradition. And so when Jesus showed up and did what he did, it was like declaring war on the religious establishment of the day. But this Sabbath, with all of its rules, it was just another symbol of the religious bondage that God's people were experiencing in the first century. It was a crushing burden. And so Jesus and his disciples walk along, and they're hungry. So they pick some of the heads of grain, and they begin to eat it. And to the Pharisees, well, they've broken the Sabbath law. Because now they've harvested grain on the Sabbath. They have worked on the Sabbath. And this is a crossroads moment because the Pharisees see this and they think this can't be happening. And Jesus knows exactly what's happening. And the disciples are like, "Oh my goodness, what's happening?" And it's this real crossroads moment. A crossroads moment where the disciples had a specific question in mind. It's an interesting question. It's a question that I think many of us have wrestled with. And if you grew up in religion, there may have been a time you wrestled with this. Maybe you're wrestling with it now. This is an interesting question. I want you to process this question. What do you do? What do you do when obeying God means defying your religion? What do you do when to obey God means you actually defy religion. That is a crossroads moment. And the Pharisees were in it, and perhaps the disciples were in it, and Jesus was leading. He was leading this moment. Now, for a few years in my life, I spent some time in religion. It was just a few years, and it was this one religious tradition that I was a part of. And I was a part of the group of people that helped conduct the service. And so throughout the service, I would help the religious leader carry out the service. And I remember a few parts of this that were pretty interesting. I remember I would wear a white robe when I did this, white robe that went all the way down to my feet. And I would carry books or carry other elements that went along with the service. I remember carrying this all out. And the thing I think I remember most is I would be in front of a group of people during the service, not a large crowd, maybe 70 to 80, 90 people. And I was young. I was probably 10 maybe or 11, and I didn't quite know what was going on, but every time I was up there, I'd have to yawn. Every time I was up there, I'd have to yawn because, well, it was religion and it was kind of tiring. And so I'm up there in front of these people and I have to yawn, and I discovered this strategy for yawning without opening your mouth. I'd like to think I'm an expert on it. I call it the church yawn. If you practice it, feel free to practice it now. You can yawn with keeping your mouth closed. That's what I remember most about this. But I was reminded of my experience in this tradition a few years back. I was going through some old family photos and I came across this picture that was very interesting. I was inside of this religious tradition and I was kneeling on the ground. And there was an elderly gentleman with a very large white hat on, and he had his hands on my forehead. It was this blessing, or it was this prayer, it was this confirmation type moment. And I saw that and I flashed back to learning how to pull off a church yawn. I flashed back to the white robes and I thought to myself, man, things have sure changed for you, Eric. I mean, that looks nothing like what worship looks like now for you. And as I thought back to that moment, to that season in my life, I'm not bitter. I'm not bitter about that part of my past. But I can recall this. I knew far more about that tradition than I did about the truth of Jesus. I was far more acquainted with the traditions of that religion than the truth of the gospel. And I think this can be very common for many people who grow up in religion. In fact, somebody recently told me at one of our locations after one of the sermons, they said, I learned more in those 30 minutes about who Jesus is and what he did, the gospel, than I did in 30 years of my religion. It's so interesting how this happens. There seems to be this crossroads for many people when they grew up in religion, this crossroads where they have to separate truth from tradition. It's a very difficult process. So what do you do when following God means giving up on a tradition? Following God means defying a tradition or defying your religion. Now back to Mark for a little bit. Jesus used David as sort of a case study for what is happening on this Sabbath. What David did back in the Old Testament was very fascinating. And Jesus is picking up on this king that the Pharisees would have looked up to and they would have loved. And he's saying, look, you remember what David did? He actually did break a law. I mean, that food that was on the table, it was reserved for the priests alone. David, not a priest, took the food and gave it to his companions because he was hungry. And what Jesus is saying is this, you religious leaders, you give him a pass for doing that. But why won't you give me a pass for what I'm doing in this field today? Jesus is making an incredible point. Isn't God far more concerned about the needs of people than the rules that people have made up? This is what he means when he says the Sabbath is for man, not man for the Sabbath. So this happens in Mark 2, but it happens all over again with something a little bit different in Mark chapter 3. Let me read to you another fascinating moment. Another time, Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Because if Jesus would do something good on the Sabbath and heal, the Pharisees thought to themselves, now we can nail him for this. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, stand up in front of everyone. Then Jesus asked them, which is lawful on the Sabbath? He kind of looks around, which is lawful on the Sabbath? To do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they remained silent, because of course you could do good on the Sabbath. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, their hard hearts. He said to the man, stretch out your hand. So he stretched it out and his hands were completely restored. So Jesus heals on the Sabbath. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus. So Jesus heals on the Sabbath, and they can't believe it because, come on, this is working on the Sabbath. So once again, Jesus has violated their tradition. Now, this is what I just find so interesting about this small story. The Pharisees are so incensed about what Jesus would do, they decide to team up with the Herodians. Now, this was unheard of. Herodians are Jewish people who are supportive of King Herod and follow what King Herod says. But the rest of the Jews couldn't stand King Herod. They were reluctant to do what he said. So why would they team up? Why would they work together on this? Well, one common enemy can bring other groups of people who used to be enemies together. And this is what's happening. The Pharisees see Jesus as such an enemy. They would team up with somebody they cannot stand and don't get along with just so that they can get Jesus back for all of this. Now, here's what's so interesting in this story as well. This man is healed, and the Pharisees could care less. They would rather this man continue to suffer with what he's going through than Jesus to heal him, because come on, how could he violate their tradition for the sake of love towards this man? They couldn't stand it. So here's what's interesting, and this thing can happen to us today. Your heart hardens. The Pharisees' hearts hardened when they scoffed at people's hearts being softened. Whenever someone takes the next step towards Jesus, whenever somebody makes a commitment to follow Jesus, whenever someone gets baptized and we sit back and say, come on, them. We cross our arms, come on, them, no way. This isn't real, they're faking it. I mean, come on, they gotta change first, or we'll see if this really sticks. Whenever we do that, whenever we scoff and just minimize someone's life change story, it actually hardens our hearts. It can cause us to grow cynical. And the Pharisees were so hardened, they were so cynical, that they could not see this gift that Jesus provided to this man. They could not see life change. And sometimes that can happen. Don't let that happen to you. Don't let your heart grow hard when you see someone's heart growing soft to who Jesus actually is. Now, we've looked at Mark 2, what Jesus did on the Sabbath. We looked at Mark 3 and what Jesus did on the Sabbath. Let's jump ahead to Mark 7, because in Mark 7, Jesus says something that really sums up everything that he was doing around these man-made traditions. He calls it all out. Look at what he says in Mark 7. The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem, they gathered around Jesus. So these Pharisees, these teachers, they gather around, and some of his disciples eating food. And look at this, with hands that were defiled, that is unwashed. With unwashed hands, Jesus and his disciples are eating. Now, the problem here is not a sanitation problem. It's a purification problem. It's not a sanitation problem. I mean, once again, Jesus and his disciples, they are violating these Jewish traditions. So of course, they're upset. Verse 3, the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial wash. So you gotta go through the ceremonial washing if you're gonna eat. This is holding to the tradition of the elders, not the truth of God, not the truth of God's word. No, this is just according to the tradition of religion, the tradition of the elders. And when they came from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash, and they observe many other traditions, such as the washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. So the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with defiled hands? Like, Jesus, why are you doing this? Why haven't you followed the traditions that we've all followed? Why are you breaking those traditions? And Jesus replied, Isaiah was right. He quotes from Isaiah. Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They honor me with all of their traditions, but those traditions, they have not impacted their hearts. In fact, their hearts are far from me, but here's the problem. They think they're close to me because they followed the traditions, and this makes them hypocrites. He goes on, they worship me in vain. Their teachings, and this is so important, their teachings are merely human rules. They are not teaching the truth of God. They are teaching human rules. And then he says this, you have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human tradition. you've let go of what God has said and you're really more committed and more devoted to the traditions of people, human traditions. At SMCC, we call that religion. So Jesus has diagnosed the real problem. He's diagnosed the real problem. They love the traditions of people more than they love the truth of God. So it was time to defy religion, to obey God. It was time to defy human tradition, to follow after and worship and obey God. Now, this can still happen, can't it? This can still happen to any one of us. And maybe as I'm talking, you're thinking, this pretty accurately describes my religious upbringing. I want to give you two ways. You can know that you've crossed over. You've crossed over from following God to religious tradition. Here's the first. You know you've crossed over into religious tradition when you love the traditions of people more than you love God's mission for people. And this is what we see when Jesus heals that man. They couldn't stand it. They couldn't stand that Jesus would exist to heal people and to save people, that Jesus would do this for people. They couldn't stand that. Why? Because they were more committed to their own traditions, the traditions of people, more than God's mission for people. Now, I want to kind of illustrate this with a quick story. A few years back, some friends of mine brought their friends to SMCC on Baptism Sunday. So some friends of mine bring their friends who do not go to SMCC but do consider themselves religious and spiritual, and they brought them to SMCC, and the service happened. And it was a Baptism Sunday, by the way. And hey, just so you know, Baptism Sunday, our next one here, is happening Easter Sunday. If you think you might want to get baptized on Easter Sunday, you could fill out the Connect card in the seat in front of you in Lehi, or message us through our connection page on the website. But that's our next Baptism Sunday. But back to the story. It was Baptism Sunday, and these people get baptized at SMCC. And it's a great service. If you've been a part of these services, you know how awesome they are. It's a service full of celebration, people being rescued, people being sort of delivered from so many things in their lives, but ultimately people being forgiven for their sin. It was awesome. It was an awesome Sunday. And on the way out, my friend said to their friends who they brought, "Hey, what'd you think of the service? You know, what was it like? What'd you think?" And here's what those friends said back to my friends. They said this: "I feel like I'm halfway to hell right now." Whoa, I've never heard that before. It's like the AC/DC song, "Highway to Hell." I've never heard that before. And so my friends followed up with their friends. "Hey, what do you mean by that?" And they said this: "You know, all the coffee and the donuts that people are eating in the auditorium, the clothes, the jeans with the holes in the knees, the music, the lights, and all the tattoos, I feel like we're halfway to hell right now." And I've been thinking about this a lot. I'll never forget that statement. I'll never forget that phrase, because inside of this incredible celebration of life change, of people taking their next steps to know Jesus, this couple, this family, they were unable to see God's goodness in people's lives because they couldn't get past these traditions that they held onto. And because it looked different at SMCC, they thought God could not be involved, because they assumed God could only be involved in their traditions. And so their hearts were hardened with a statement like that, when on that Sunday at SMCC, hundreds and hundreds of people's hearts were softened by the work of God. So you know you've crossed over into tradition, when you are more concerned, when you're more concerned with the traditions of people than you are with God's mission for people. Jesus came for people. But here's the second way you can know you've crossed over into tradition. It's this: when you're more concerned with the what than the why of Jesus's actions. More concerned with the what than the why of Jesus's actions. See, Jesus was fed up with the religious rules of the day. All these religious rules placed on people, they replaced helpful principles with rules. Rules took the place of principles, and then those rules became a burden on top of people. And sometimes this can happen when we have good intentions, but just bad execution. And the Pharisees and religious leaders who do this, they think this: you know what? I need to help people change. I need to get people to change. We need to speed up the process in which people change. So let's put some fences up. Let's put some rules up around them. And by putting up these fences and rules, we'll prevent sin from impacting people's behavior. And we're gonna help them along. But what this does unintentionally is it sabotages delight in Jesus, because all people see is duty and devotion to the rules. And rules can never give us love. Rules can never give us delight. But Jesus can. So at SMCC, we honor the process. We honor the process that God changes people from the inside out. Only He can do that. See, Jesus talked about it. We can't change from the outside in. We change from the inside out. So we want to honor that process. Honor the process that God changes people from the inside out. Sometimes people think if we put more biblical rules around people, we put up more fences, it will help. But ultimately, it undermines what we really want all together. Now, last year at our house, we installed a fence around our property, a fence around our place, for a few reasons. One of the reasons we put in a fence is to keep all the Utah kids out of our backyard. No one told us that in Utah, kids are truly free-range animals. They're coming into our backyard, knocking on our back door, asking for food. I had no idea that that happened in Utah. So we put up a fence to keep them out. We also put up a fence to keep Archie, the Nelson's dog, in. And a few days after the fence went up, I was looking out into the backyard, and my kids were playing in the backyard, and I see them throwing the ball up and over the fence, because the kids that live next door are my kids' friends, and without a fence, they used to play face to face. They'd know each other. They could talk to each other. But now, there was an 8-foot fence up. And so they're talking, "Hey, is that you? I can't see you. Are you over there?" And the ball's going back and forth. My kids couldn't see their friends. I mean, the relationship had this big wall up now. This big fence had been put up. Now, I'm not upset I put up a fence. It was the right move for us. But this illustrates something that I think is very, very important. Religion can put up a fence. The rules of religion, they can put up a fence that keeps us from God. See, religion puts up fences, and the assumption is, you know what, we're gonna prevent those bad things out there from getting people. But really what we're preventing is we're preventing people from having a close relationship with God. It's like, "God, are you over there? God, I can't see you anymore, because all I see is an 8-foot fence of the rules of my religion." Sometimes all we see is rules, and the religious leaders of Jesus' day and religious leaders today build fences thinking it'll keep bad behavior out, that it'll somehow protect, but it really just prevents people from seeing who Jesus is. And Jesus, He took the fence down. He took the rules, He took the fences that had been established by human tradition, and He took it down, and He said, "If you want to know what God is like, look at me." He says, "You want to know what God is like? You want to have a relationship with Him? Follow me." And that's exactly what people did. So if you were there that day, if you were there that day when the Pharisees were there and the Herodians were there and the disciples were there, who would you have sided with? If you were there that day, who would you have sided with? Would you have defied Jesus to stay with tradition? Or would you have defied tradition to take your next steps with Jesus? And some of you know exactly what you would have done, because you've already done this. And your courage is so incredibly inspiring to me. And some of you are in the process of doing this, and you're thinking about it right now, and you're weighing out the pros and the cons. You're counting the cost of what it would mean for you to defy religion or defy the tradition of people, or the tradition of the family that you grew up in, the traditions you inherited from people you love, to follow Jesus. And if you're in that process, you're not alone. You're not alone. But I want to tell you one thing that I think would be very helpful for you to know, because it might feel like the warm blanket of tradition is about to be taken away. But here's what I want you to know. Truth is more comfortable than tradition in time. See, in time, tradition can let you down hard. When you come to discover that a tradition you loved was not true, it can feel like everything is crumbling around you. But in time, living your life aligned with what's true about you and the world and God, living your life aligned with reality is far more comforting than living life simply aligned with a tradition that was made up by people. It is worth it. It is worth it to follow truth, even if that feels uncomfortable. because over time, truth is far more comfortable than tradition. And if Peter were here, he would say tradition almost stood in the way forever. If Peter were here, he would say what Jesus did revolutionized the world spiritually. If Peter were here, he would say it is worth it to go with truth over tradition. Peter wrestled with this in his own life. But later he would write about all this. See, Peter watched religious leaders put up fences. And so Peter would also instruct spiritual leaders, Christians, to lead differently. So in the tail end of his letter, his first letter to a group of Jesus followers, 1 Peter chapter 5, he writes to the group of religious leaders who are overseeing communities of Jesus' people. And he says this. He says, "To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed." So he's writing to elders. Elders were overseers of these communities. The Greek word for this is they were presbyteros. They were a group of elders or overseers. And he's writing to them and he's saying, you can lead differently than the way the Pharisees have led for years and years. He says, be shepherds of God's flock. Shepherds, people who care. He says, be shepherds of God's flock that's under your care, watching over them. Not because you must, not because you have to, but because you're willing. This isn't a have to, it's a want to. Because you're willing, as God wants you to be. Not pursuing dishonest gain. You're not in this because you're interested in your personal gain. You're in this because you want people to thrive in their relationship with Jesus. He says, not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you. Lording it over. Jesus once talked about that to Peter personally. We're going to look at that later in the series. Peter picks up on that phrase. He uses it again here in his letter. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd, the chief overseer appears, that would be Jesus, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Wow. What a description of leadership. You know, at SMCC, we too have elders. We have overseers. And this is exactly what they're doing. They care about our church. They care about the health of our church. They care about the people who attend our church. They are overseeing the health of our church. And they're doing that because they want to. They're eager to serve. They are servants who want to help other people thrive in their relationship with Jesus. So the Pharisees, they stood in the way. They stood in the way of people who were going to follow Jesus. They stood in the way, but Peter and the elders and elders over churches ever since, our overseers here, they led the way. They didn't stand in the way, but they led the way, helping people see through traditions, through the rules made up by people, to see the truth of the gospel. So the bottom line in our message today is this: requiring more rules, more traditions, requiring more than God does, it can lead to devotion, but it will ruin delight. You can get devotion out of people in religion, but it will ruin delight. So what do you do when you have to defy human tradition, when you have to defy human rules or religion to honor God? What do? Well, you do it. You do it. And if you're in this process, you're in the messy middle, you're in the aftermath of maybe walking away from a tradition so that you could walk towards Jesus. It might be an uncomfortable season for you, but I want to encourage you to keep going. Don't turn back to tradition. Keep taking your next step to follow Jesus, because the rules of religion and the rules of tradition, they can't lead to delight. Devotion to rules, it won't lead to delight, but devotion to Jesus, a person, absolutely will. So let's continue to be a church. Let's continue to be a church where people who feel like they've gotten the warm blanket of tradition taken away from them are comforted. Let's be that type of church. And let's be the type of church that honors the process that God changes people from the inside out, because this is the type of change that Jesus talked about. See, we're all in process. We all have a next step to take. So if you're in process, if you're in the process of turning from tradition to the truth of the gospel, you belong here and you are welcomed here, because we are all in process. So we're all in this together. And let's remember one more thing. Truth is far more comfortable than tradition in time. Would you pray with me? We'll continue in our service. God, thank you for everything that Jesus did. Thank you for what he said about tradition and the way he challenged human rules, the rules of religion. And I think those rules and those traditions have impacted many of us. And for some of us, maybe we want nothing to do with you because all we can see are the rules of religion in our past, and there's a big fence that's been put up. Jesus, we thank you that you took the fence down. You made a way of salvation for all of us. And so today I pray that we would take our next step to know you. Whatever our next step might be, I pray we would take it, knowing that truth is far more comfortable than tradition and time, and knowing that delight is the byproduct of following after you. Jesus, we love you, and we thank you for this conversation we've been able to have. We want to worship you now, not worship in vain, as the Pharisees do, but worship you from our hearts. It's in your name that we pray, Jesus, amen.
You put your love on the line to bear the weight of sin that was mine, washing my river of wrong into the sea of your infinite love.
thank you, Shauna and the band, for leading us in that song. And I just want to thank those of you that are still here with us. Hey, thank you for joining us again. We just really appreciate it. And I want to remind you that if you're curious about what next step to take, if you're curious about what to find next in participating with SMCC, you can visit right now smccutah.org/next-steps. And there's plenty of options there, including just connecting with one of our staff. So we'd really appreciate that. And just as well, if you love what you're seeing at SMCC, maybe you've been attending for a while now and you say, hey, I want to fund the mission of SMCC to get more helpful and hopeful content out there to help as many people as possible to take their next step in full devotion and full delight in Jesus Christ. What you can do is help us out by visiting smccutah.org/give, and you can partner with us financially. Well, thank you again for being here for SMCC Online, and I will see you again next week.